In aviation history, few aircraft capture the imagination quite like the de Havilland Sea Vixen. With its alien-like twin-boom design and offset cockpit, this British bird of prey looks like it flew straight out of a science fiction movie. But make no mistake, the Sea Vixen was very real, and it packed a punch that made it the terror of the skies during the Cold War. As the last all-British fighter to serve with the Royal Navy's fleet air arm, it represented the pinnacle of British aerospace innovation, defending the nation's interests across the globe for over two decades. A fighter jet armed with cutting-edge missiles and able to intercept enemy bombers in pitch darkness or raging storms, the Sea Vixen was a true pilot's aircraft that pushed the boundaries of naval aviation. Its swept wings and powerful Rolls-Royce Avon engines propelled it to near-sonic speeds, while its advanced radar system gave it eyes that could pierce through the blackest night. But what truly set the Sea Vixen apart was its unconventional two-man crew arrangement. While it presented unique challenges, its configuration allowed for unparalleled specialization in combat roles, making the Sea Vixen a fearsome predator. The origins of the Sea Vixen go back to 1946 when de Havilland began discussions with the British Admiralty about requirements for a future jet-powered, all-weather, radar-equipped fighter. These talks revealed several key requirements: a two-man crew to handle the complex radar and navigation equipment, twin engines for safety over water, and swept wings for high-speed performance. In response, de Havilland began work on the DH-110 design in 1947. The project aimed to create a versatile platform capable of serving as an interceptor for the Royal Air Force and a fleet defense fighter for the Royal Navy. This dual-role approach was ambitious, seeking to create a single airframe that could meet the diverse needs of both services. The first DH-110 prototype, designated WG-236, incorporated several innovative design elements that would define the aircraft. At the heart of the DH-110 was its all-metal semi-monocoque structure, a significant departure from earlier de Havilland designs that used wood. This construction provided greater strength and durability, essential for withstanding the stresses of high-speed flight and carrier operations. The fuselage was divided into several sections, with the central portion housing the cockpit, fuel tanks, and engine bays. The DH-110 retained the twin-boom layout seen in de Havilland's earlier Vampire and Venom fighters, but with significant advancements. This configuration allowed for a shorter, more compact fuselage, highly beneficial for carrier operations. The booms extended rearward from the wing, supporting the tailplane and vertical stabilizers. Their structural rigidity and additional fuel storage were a critical factor in extending the aircraft's range and endurance. The wing design of the DH-110 was a key feature, incorporating a 45-degree sweep with a thickness-to-chord ratio of 10% at the root, tapering to 8% at the tip. This sweep angle was chosen as a compromise between high-speed performance and low-speed handling characteristics, essential for an aircraft expected to operate from carriers. For this same reason, the wings incorporated hydraulically powered ailerons and large split flaps. In the tail section, the twin boom design supported a high-mounted tailplane, which reduced interference from wing vortices and engine exhaust. Initially, the tailplane was fixed, but later versions would incorporate an all-moving tailplane for improved control at transonic speeds, a modification that greatly enhanced the aircraft's high-speed handling characteristics. One of the most distinctive features of the DH-110 was its cockpit arrangement. The pilot's position was offset to the left, while the observer, who acted as radar operator and navigator, was housed in a compartment to the right entirely within the fuselage. This unusual configuration, which would later earn the nickname coal hole for the observer's position, provided the observer with a dark environment for better visibility of the radar screens. While innovative, this would later prove controversial due to outward visibility and safety concerns for the observer. Powering the DH-110 were two Rolls-Royce Avon RA, three turbojet engines, each capable of producing 6,500 pounds of force of thrust. These engines were housed in the central fuselage with intakes on either side of the cockpit and exhausts beneath the tail booms. This twin-engine configuration provided the necessary power for high-speed flight and offered a measure of redundancy, characteristic of aircraft used in overwater operations. The landing gear of the prototype featured a conventional tricycle arrangement. The nose gear retracted forward into the fuselage, while the main gear retracted inward into the wing roots. This configuration would later be strengthened and modified to withstand the rigors of carrier operations. In terms of armament, the initial schematics called for four 30mm Aden cannons housed in the lower fuselage beneath the cockpit. This potent armament was intended to give the DH 110 significant firepower against both air and surface targets. The aircraft was also designed to house an AI 18 radar system in the nose, providing all-weather interception capabilities, a critical feature for its intended role as an interceptor. The wing design of the DH-110 was a key feature, incorporating a 45-degree sweep with a thickness-to-chord ratio of 10% at the root, tapering to 8% at the tip. These enabled accurate long-range interception missions. For communications, the aircraft featured UHF and VHF radios, allowing for clear contact with ground controllers and other aircraft. On September 26, 1951, the DH-110 prototype took to the skies for its inaugural flight, initiating a rigorous period of testing and evaluation. Early flight tests demonstrated exceptional performance, with the aircraft achieving supersonic speeds in a shallow dive by April 1952. This accomplishment placed the DH-110 at the forefront of fighter technology. However, the promising start of the DH-110 program was marred by tragedy. On September 6, 1952, during a demonstration at the Farnborough Airshow, the first prototype disintegrated mid-flight, resulting in the loss of both crew members and 29 spectators. This catastrophic event led to a thorough investigation and subsequent redesign of the aircraft. The investigation revealed that the wing structure had failed due to oscillations induced by transonic airflow. In response, de Havilland implemented significant structural changes. The wings were substantially reinforced to withstand the stresses of high-speed flight. This included additional ribs and spars, as well as thickened skin in critical areas. A prominent wing fence was added to each wing, improving airflow characteristics and reducing the risk of sudden aerodynamic breakup at transonic speeds. One of the most significant changes was the replacement of the fixed tailplane with an all-moving surface. This modification provided better control authority at high speeds and improved the aircraft's ability to recover from high-speed stalls. The fuselage was also strengthened to improve overall structural integrity, particularly in the areas connecting the wing and tail booms to the central structure. These modifications delayed the program, but ultimately resulted in a more robust and reliable airframe. The second prototype, WG-240, incorporated these changes and resumed flight testing in June 1954. Despite the improvements, the RAF decided to abandon its interest in the DH-110, opting instead for the Gloucester Javelin. However, the Royal Navy remained interested in the design as a potential fleet defense fighter. As the Royal Navy showed interest in the DH-110, further modifications were made to create what would become the Sea Vixen. A complex hydraulic folding mechanism was introduced, allowing the outer sections of the wings to fold upwards for carrier storage. This ingenious system reduced the aircraft's wingspan from 51 feet to 31 feet when folded, a useful feature for maximizing storage space on crowded carrier decks. A robust arrestor hook was installed beneath the rear fuselage, enabling carrier operations. This hook could withstand the extreme forces experienced during arrested landings on carrier decks. The landing gear was also significantly reinforced and equipped with oleopneumatic shock absorbers to handle the stresses of carrier landings. The nose gear was fitted with a catapult sprag, a necessary addition for steam catapult launches from carrier decks. The AI-18 radar system was adapted for naval use, with additional maritime modes added for surface search and target identification. These enhancements made the Sea Vixen a more versatile platform, capable of both air defense and maritime strike missions. The production Sea Vixen FOW-1, an abbreviation of Fighter All-Weather Mark I, incorporated naval adaptations and featured several advancements over the prototype. The aircraft measured 55 feet 7 inches in length, with a wingspan of 51 feet and a height of 10 feet 9 inches. Its wing area totaled 648 square feet, providing ample lift for carrier operations. Empty, the Sea Vixen weighed 27,950 pounds, while its maximum takeoff weight reached 41,575 pounds, showcasing its significant payload capacity. Propulsion came from two Rolls-Royce Avon 208 turbojets, each producing 11,000 pounds of thrust. This powerful combination gave the Sea Vixen impressive performance figures. At sea level, it could reach a maximum speed of Mach 0.91, equivalent to 690 miles per hour, and climb at a rate of 9,000 feet per minute. The aircraft's service ceiling was 48,000 feet, allowing it to intercept high-altitude targets. On internal fuel alone, the Sea Vixen had a range of 790 miles, extendable through external drop tanks. The FAW-1 was intended to give the DH-110 significant firepower against both air and surface targets. The aircraft was also designed to house an AI-18 radar system in the nose, providing all-weather interception capabilities, a critical feature for its intended role as an interceptor. Several unique systems set the Sea Vixen apart. Its complex fuel system comprised multiple integral tanks in the wings and fuselage, with a total capacity of 1,100 imperial gallons. Dual independent hydraulic systems powered various aircraft functions, while electrical needs were met by a 115 VAC system with a ram air turbine for emergency power. The Sea Vixen's avionics suite was advanced for its time, centered around the improved AI-18 radar. This system provided search, track, and targeting capabilities with a range of approximately 30 nautical miles, effective against targets from sea level to 70,000 feet. An integrated weapons management system coordinated the radar, navigation systems, and weapons controls. Navigation capabilities were further enhanced with a tactical air navigation system, TACAN, improving the aircraft's ability to operate far from land-based navigational aids. The FAW-2 variant, introduced in 1964, brought significant improvements to the Sea Vixen design. The most noticeable change was the extension of the tail booms forward of the wing leading edge. This modification increased fuel capacity by 120 imperial gallons and provided space for additional electronic countermeasures equipment, enhancing both range and survivability. Armament on the FAW-2 was upgraded to include the more advanced red-top air-to-air missiles. These second-generation missiles offered improved range, maneuverability, and kill probability compared to the earlier Firestreak, significantly boosting the Sea Vixen's air-to-air combat capabilities. The FAW-2's avionics saw substantial upgrades. An improved AI-18 radar system was installed, offering better detection and tracking capabilities. New electronic countermeasures equipment in the extended tail booms provided enhanced protection against radar-guided threats. The communications suite was also upgraded with a secure system for transmitting sensitive information during operations. Cockpit improvements were a key feature of the FAW-2. The observer's position received a larger, frangible perspex canopy, allowing for easier emergency egress. This addressed a major criticism of the original coal hole design. The pilot's canopy was modified to remove the central frame, improving visibility and situational awareness. Crew safety was further enhanced with the installation of Martin Baker Mech 6 ejection seats. These advanced seats provided improved survival chances in a wider range of emergency scenarios, including underwater ejection, a crucial feature for a carrier-based aircraft. These enhancements made the FAW-2 a more capable and survivable platform, better suited to the evolving threats of the Cold War era. The Sea Vixen served with the Fleet Air Arm from 1959 to 1972, playing a crucial role in Britain's naval air defense during a period of significant global tensions. Its advanced design and capabilities represented the pinnacle of British naval aviation technology in the early Cold War period, bridging the gap between the first generation of jet fighters and the more advanced multi-role combat aircraft that would follow. Throughout its career, the Sea Vixen participated in several operations, including the Kuwait Crisis of 1961 and the Indonesia-Malaysia confrontation from 1963 to 1966. These deployments demonstrated the aircraft's versatility and importance to Britain's global naval presence. However, the Sea Vixen's service was not without challenges. The aircraft had a relatively high accident rate, with 55 out of the 145 produced being lost in crashes. Many of these accidents were fatal, highlighting the inherent dangers of carrier-based aviation and some of the aircraft's design shortcomings, particularly the problematic observer's position in early models. The Sea Vixen's retirement in 1972 marked the end of an era for British naval aviation. It was replaced by the McDonnell Douglas Phantom FG-1, signaling a shift towards adopting American aircraft in the Royal Navy. After retirement, several Sea Vixens found new roles as target tugs and in weapons testing. Today, the legacy of the Sea Vixen lives on through preserved examples in museums across the United Kingdom, and the memories of those who flew and maintained this unique aircraft. Its distinctive design and advanced capabilities for its time ensure that the Sea Vixen remains an iconic symbol of British naval aviation history, representing a period of rapid technological advancement and the challenges of adapting jet aircraft to carrier operations.